Hi, everybody. Welcome to Jay Leno's Garage. Well, this week, we're not going to be in my garage. We're on our way to Pebble Beach, the ultimate car week. Now, Pebble Beach is kind of like the Super Bowl for car enthusiasts. You'll see some of the greatest cars ever built. We'll take you to the Concours de Le Mans, where you'll see some of the worst cars ever built. We'll show you an exclusive look at a couple of supercars being built. And we're going to show you a car that is 50 years old, but is being built by a major manufacturer exactly the same way it was 50 years ago. Is that a business plan? I don't know. We'll find out. But right now, let's go back to the beginning. We're going to take you for a ride in a 1907 white steam car. We're here in the field at Pebble Beach getting ready to go on the tour. This is Mitch Gross and his wife, Wendy. This is their 1907 white steam car. Come on, tell us a little bit about the car.
Well, this is a Model G, which is a big 30 horsepower white steam car. And white was trying to compete with all the big gas-powered internal explosion cars. And they built this car to be the upscale, high-priced model for their customers.
And at the time, steam really was superior to internal combustion.
Yeah, it was.
And 30 horsepower, these are big Clydesdales. These are not, 30 horsepower doesn't sound like much now, but these have a lot of torque. They have a lot of power. These are quite fast cars, weren't they?
Yeah, we estimate the torque on this to be upwards of 1,750 foot-pounds.
Wow, so, okay, yeah. So there you go.
It's
so
got a 6-inch piston. So.
And white was the first White House cars. They were the first cars bought by the military. And this car is important because this was on the show stand, what, 1906, 1907?
1906, yeah. They were trying to advertise the Model H, which is the small version that they wanted to sell to everyone, with the big version, the Model G.
Let me show you how this thing starts up.
Once you light your pilot, you wait for steam to build up. Let's check. Okay, got a little steam pressure. Now you want to run the engine a little bit to evacuate all the water from the system so you're left with nothing but superheated steam. Now we're really ready to go.
Have you seen one of these?
Ah, that I love. Yeah, there you go. You're a good driver.
Yeah, thanks.
You drive it better than I do.
Howdy, boys. I wonder if I want to live with a golf course right in my front yard. What am I hearing?
That's the chain.
Okay. Didn't break, did it?
No.
Doesn't sound good.
Doesn't sound good at all. Oh, wait, stop, stop, stop. Yeah, chain's off.
Chain jumped the sprocket. Adventures of early motoring.
There we go.
You got enough slack?
Yep, it's okay. On.
That's another mess, Ali.
Yeah.
There we go. Just a minor inconvenience. Uh-oh.
Yeah, we got something broken.
She's not turning.
We'll have to go up a little bit and pull over.
Right here.
Right here is good.
Well, the shaft is bent. You're sitting in traffic and you build up a lot of steam pressure and cylinder locks. You're gonna earn long pants if you get this done. Well, there's only one thing to do. You know, 100 years ago, there were about 350 car companies in America. And every year, 5 or 10% would drop off. You know, in recent years, we've lost Pontiac, we've lost Oldsmobile. So new car companies are rare. It usually takes, 7 to 10 years to turn a profit. But McLaren has sort of beaten the odds. They've turned a profit in just 4 years, which is pretty amazing, because this is a very competitive, very tough business. Let's find out how they did it. Come on. Now, we have something here.
Yeah.
I know what it is. I haven't seen it yet. Actually, no one really has seen it yet, and hopefully you'll see it for the first time, just as I am right now. Tell people what we have.
This is the P1 GTR, literally unveiling it to the public today. This is a car that wasn't in the plan originally. The plan was 375 P1s.
Right.
What happened was we had a number of customers come back to us and say, what else could you do? What could you do if you made it a pure track car or a race car?
And you were going to unveil it later today. We're going to get a sneak peek. Is that correct?
We can have a sneak. Yeah.
All right. Let's
see the car.
I would love to see the car. Okay. Wow, very impressive. And of course, the legendary Chris Goodwin. He is the famous McLaren test driver. He's put more miles on McLarens than just about anybody else in the world.
That's true. So we've taken the base petrol engine up in power, and we've taken the e-motor up in power as well. So this is 1,000 PS. It's 985 horsepower.
Now, the most dramatic view of the car has to be from the rear. Come on, let's take a look.
Without a doubt.
Well, this is like howitzers out the exhaust.
Well, we're completely unfettered by homologation, by road legislation. So we've just been able to take to the extreme. We've taken the grills off the back.
Right.
There's no purpose for them. We've been able to free up the exhaust. It's a very, very focused car. As I say, it's as much about the package as it is about the vehicle. Our estimate is we'll be sort of low double digits, maybe 20 to 30.
Oh, okay.
But we're not setting the volume. That's down to P1 customers.
And what will the price of this be?
Just short of £2 million.
£2 million, okay.
Including
floor mats.
No, complete package.
Yeah, pretty amazing car. Pretty amazing car. Well, the P1 road car is my favorite, and it's just a wonderful, wonderful automobile. I mean, this just takes it to the next step. So, Mike, thank you very much.
Pleasure. Great to see you again, Jay.
Thank you very much. Add a Ron for him.
I will indeed.
You know, Pebble Beach is one of the most beautiful places in the world, and what better place to introduce a new product, an equally beautiful product. This is the new Alpha 4C. Of course, that stands for Alfa Romeo, a company that's been out of the American market for almost 20 years. Let's meet Michael Barraby. Michael, how are you? Now, you're the Alfa Romeo, product development guy?
Yep.
Okay. When they left the American market, not with the best reputation. The Italian electrics were a little sketchy. I think that's being fair to say. They're a wonderful product, wonderful engineered, but what's the plan this time?
Well, you know, with the 4C, this is really marks the beginning of Alfa Romeo's return. It's not just one car. There'll be up to 8 new models coming out.
A lot of people might not realize that Alfa Romeo is part of the Fiat empire. And of course, they also own Chrysler, or it's a partnership. They own Chrysler. Will Alfa Romeo be sold through Chrysler dealerships? Will it be through Fiat dealerships? Will it be standalone?
Well, there are unique Alfa Romeo franchises. We've announced 86 in North America, 4 in Canada, the rest in the US. There are full-time Alfa Romeo stores. They have Alfa Romeo trained salespeople, technicians.
This is not an inexpensive car. It's a high-end car, isn't it?
The car starts at $72,000 for the first launch edition. But after that, it's a $54,000 starting price car.
And of course, these come fully equipped, air conditioning, the whole deal.
Yeah.
I can remember air conditioning in the old Alfa. I mean, it was hilarious. But it's a new company. We have learned from the past. And, you know, to us old guys, we love and remember Alfa Romeo. And there's a whole generation of people that this car is being reintroduced to. So they're not familiar with the brand. So it's really terrific. Can we take it for a ride?
Absolutely. I'd love to.
Let's do it. But does it sound like an Alfa Romeo? Let's see. It sounds like an Alfa Romeo. You know, most people never driven a really light car. Most cars are pretty heavy. So driving something that's only under 2,500 pounds is a real revelation. I like the single wiper.
Yeah.
Shifts quickly, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Plenty of leg room in the car. I'm 6 feet tall, and I'm not cramped at all.
I've seen guys up to 6'4", and they fit fine. Yeah. There's actually more headroom than a lot of people think.
And that ocean, you can really smell it here, can't you?
Yeah.
See, if this was one of the Alphas from the 60s, we would have rusted just going through here. from the bad steel. But those days are gone forever.
Gone. Hey, Jay, pull over up here.
Up here?
Yeah.
Okay. Really impressive.
I got, stuff I gotta do. I got a few people to show the car to. You know, there's a lot to be in the car. So,
let's do it.
All right.
Michael? This is my limited production ZR1 Corvette. When this came out, it was the most powerful Corvette Chevrolet had ever made. In fact, they said to me, Jay, with 640 horsepower, it'll be a long, long time before Chevrolet builds a Corvette with more power than this one. Apparently not long enough. I'm real excited to see the new Z06.
Well, before we talk about the new car, let's take a look at the original Z06 from 63.
Okay. Yeah, this is a legendary car. Still one of the most iconic shapes of all time. The 63 split window, one of my all-time favorites. Yeah. Let's take a look at the new one. Very impressive.
Well, the first thing you notice when you see it, I mean, it's a wider car. 3 inches wider in the rear, 2 inches wider up front.
Now, will this also be available as a convertible or just a removable hardtop?
Well, this is the first time that since 63 that's been available with a convertible.
Now, I've got a ZR1. And when that came out in 2009, it was the most powerful Corvette ever with 640 horse. What do we got here?
Well, we've got 650 horse, 650 foot-pounds of torque. It's strong.
Now, you pointed out something to me here.
Yeah, the rocker on the side,
right.
All for aero. But, you know, it's hard getting in and out of the car with a big rocker
on there. Step on
so
there,
we skived it out in this area. Went back in the tunnel and ran it, and it was even better. Splitters up front,
right.
Aero fences up front.
And you got carbon ceramic brakes?
Yep.
You know, it's amazing in a car in this price class, you really have to go to the European exotics in the $250,000 to $300,000 range to get a lot of this tech. Can we open the hood on it?
Here it is, the LT4, 650 horsepower.
It's amazing how this engine has evolved. Because it doesn't have overhead cams and a lot of stuff like that, it's not carrying its weight up high, so you can have the lowest front end of almost any sports car there is.
You're right, because the engine is low.
Right.
It is compact,
yeah.
Low drag, and great downforce.
650 horsepower. And what's the price going to be?
Start around 80 grand and then go top out at around 100.
Yeah, and the Stingray has just been selling unbelievable, hasn't it?
Yeah, it's really doing well. We're selling like 3,000 units a month.
Yeah, and it looks terrific. Can we drive this one?
Jay, this is the very first car, and it's only a display model.
Oh, a display model.
It's a display model.
Display model, and you gotta live it a little, I'm telling you.
Jay.
Don't worry about it.
Jay.
You're the boss. Nobody tells Ed Welburn what to do. It's a Corvette, how can you not drive it? See, it even sounds like a Corvette.
Jay.
We're out on the field at Pebble Beach where all the cars unload. This is a 1928 Chrysler Imperial LeBaron. Now, if it looks like it's been neglected and hasn't really been polished up or shined up, that's because it hasn't. This is something fairly new in the last couple of years. It's called the preservation class. These are cars that have been maintained either by family members or a second or third owner, but not restored, not fixed up, just kept in good operating, running condition. And this car belongs to Walter Miller. He's the leading antique auto literature dealer in the country. Walter, come on in. How you doing?
Hi.
See, I love this class of vehicle because you don't have to spend any money. In fact, you actually lose points if you fix it up too nice.
That's correct.
Now, how do you prove that this car has not been touched in the last...
Most of the judges that are going to be judging in the class, they know. I mean, you can just look at the paint. Typically, you give this to a detailer and they spend hours and hours. You can't do that. This morning, I was just putting a cloth over it and a piece of paint that big came off. So the paint chips very easily because it's almost 100 years old.
Now, he's got the green ribbon. That means he did the tour. If two cars are tied, the car that did the 60-mile tour to prove that it really runs will win.
Correct.
So all the antique cars go on the tour, those that are able to, just to show that they're running cars and not just trailer queens. And where was this car found? How long you had it?
Yes, I've had it about 3 years. The man I bought it from was almost 90 years old.
Right.
And his aunt actually gave it to him when he was 10. I have photographs of him. All his friends are in the car. They called this thing the Green Goddess.
Wow.
In 1955, he stored it. Just kind of forgot about it. In 1995, he pulled it out of the garage and he had someone rebuild the engine and he drove it around once in a while. Literally never was in an antique car show in its life until I got it, which I think is pretty exemplary for a car of this. And there are there were 21 of these made when it was new.
Wow, that's all.
Chrysler was only, what, six years old when this was?
I see you brought your wife and kids. Do they enjoy coming to these shows?
Oh, they love going to these shows.
They do?
Yes. Nothing better than a car show.
Yeah, they look thrilled.
Yes.
Well, Walter, good luck.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for showing us your car.
Absolutely.
Well, here's another preservation class car. This is a 1908 Stanley Steamer. And this is probably one of the rarest cars here because Stanley Steamers are kind of like Lincoln's axe, third handle, fifth head. There aren't many original parts on them because they're made of wood and they're on fire. So just kind of understand how that happens. So most of them have been replaced over the years. The wood gets burned or charred. Whereas this one, it's an all original car. And that's what makes it exciting. This is was brought here by my friend Andy Swift. Andy, come on up here. He does Firefly restorations up there in Maine.
Hey, Jay.
Good to see you. So who does this car belong to?
It's at the Seal Cove Auto Museum, and that's who owns it.
Now, is this one you have to hand lubricate every 50 miles?
Yeah.
You got to get out?
Yeah, you're going to hand lubricate this one. This isn't a wet engine. It's
You know, most engines, of course, like he says, wet engines, they're filled with oil, and as the car runs, the oil circulates. This one, you drive it for like 30 miles, you pull over, you open it up, you shoot oil on everything, you go back in, you drive again. This car probably could win the preservation class, except the boiler is not in it, is
it? We chose not to bring the boiler because the frame's a little bit tender on it. We do have the burner in there that is original, the way it's wired.
I'll show you what we're talking about. See, for a car to win the preservation class, it's got to be able to drive up the ramp and onto the field. And as you can see, this is the burner here. This is where the fire would go. And then the boiler would be up here. But because it's not in there.
Right. A lot of the Stanley people are loving it that we bought it.
No, I love that you bought it because you get to see, you know, they've all been modified over the years. This wood is all steam bent. And the fact that it lasted well over 100 years is pretty amazing. So thanks for taking care of it.
Hey, no sweat, Jay.
And good luck, even though you can't win anyway.
Georgia.
That's a beautiful bike. Can't be many of those around. What was that, a 500?
That's a 650. Mm-hmm. The carburetor is way down here. It's got like a foot-long intake manifold that's uphill.
Use a bit of ether when you want to start it, huh? What do you got, about a one-gallon tank?
Yeah, it's pretty small, but see, there's auxiliary tanks that go here.
Oh, yeah.
Torpedoes.
Yeah. Have you driven it?
I've driven it with the sidecar. I've never driven it solo.
How is it weird? Don't be afraid of it, son. Come on.
Oh, I need a new ankle.
Hey, you need some more fluid, I think.
You know, these things never start when someone's watching.
I guess you didn't take too many trips in this.
No.
But she wants to go, you hear it kick.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We'll do it tomorrow, Jay.
Give it a shot tomorrow.
Okay.
See you then.
I wasn't prepared to start this today. Tomorrow's the show, so I'm going to mess with this in the morning.
I'm here with the president of Jaguar and Land Rover, Joe Eberhardt, and of course, my favorite designer, the man who designed some of those beautiful cars in the world, Ian Callum. Now, I want to ask you guys here, we're about to unveil, this is very exciting. This is sort of be the world premiere of a car that has not been built in, what, 50 years?
50 years, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Tell us what we have here before we see it.
Well, we many years ago, we commissioned to build 18 lightweight E-types way back in 63 or so. We only built 12 of them, and yet there were 6 VIN numbers left that we never actually built to cars. So now we're going to build those 6 cars. From brand new.
And these cars would be built exactly to the specifications of 1962?
Exactly the specification. But as I say, every part would be brand new. They'd be brand new cars, but it'd be exactly the same specification.
Joe, let me ask you this. You have the dreamers, the designers, the engineers, these guys that are passionate about cars. They're not money guys, they're passion guys. You're the financial guy, you're the boss. They come to you and they say, we want to build a 50-year-old car. Exactly, it was built 50 years ago. We're only going to make 6 of them. How do you sell that? How do you sell that to the bosses?
Well, I think the good news is that at Jaguar, everybody is a car guy. So there is no such thing as the bean counters. We all have a passion about cars and about the brand. And in this particular case, we build it because we could. We still have the tooling. We have the craftsmen. that know how to put together a car like that. So we just did it because we could. And at the end of the day, it is fulfilling what customers are looking for in a Jag.
Sure.
But what this does, it just continues to fill that brand halo and allows us to continue the growth of the company overall.
Well, let's show them what we have here. Now, Ian, you were what, 11 when this car came out?
Yeah, about then.
Did it strike you like it did the rest of us?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, I loved it. I loved it, especially the racing one, because remember, this design's a racing car.
Right.
It's a pure racing car, and that's really part of its charm.
Well, let's go back 50 years and take this off, see what we got here. Wow. Well, let's take a look. It's just a beautiful, beautiful car. Everything is exactly it was in 62. They never looked that good in 1962.
No, they didn't, actually.
No.
It was slightly asymmetric.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is perfect, absolutely perfect in every way. But the detail is also exactly to spec, even the fact that he's been screwed in and everything, you know.
And the cool thing is, this is built by Jaguar.
Built entirely by Jaguar,
That's great. It's not an outside firm and they did a restoration.
No.
This is every single part of this car is brand new.
Brand new, built by Jaguar. Of course, we bought suppliers to help us, but we bring it in. And the really nice thing is we're building this in Browns Lane where we used to build the original E-Type. We still have one factory line left there and we're building it there. So it's a real piece of history.
I don't even know how you make money on a project like this, but I don't care. This is a financial network, but we're not talking about that now. But nice job, gentlemen. Beautiful, beautiful car. Congratulations.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Well, I'm here in the golf course at Pebble Beach. This is considered probably the greatest golf course in America, if not the world. And tomorrow, this lawn will be filled with hundreds of cars. But how does it make the groundskeeper feel? Let's find out. Chris Dahlheimer, you're the groundskeeper here. Are you excited about the cars being here tomorrow?
Absolutely thrilled.
Yeah. Really? Really? Is it more work for you after the Concours?
Well, absolutely. If you're a golf course superintendent, this is one of the toughest weeks of the year. It's exciting to have all the cars in, but then the grass takes
a
beating.
Okay,
yeah, absolutely.
I mean, what kind of beating? Oil falls on the grass, that kind of thing?
Yeah, you name it. You got oil leaks, you got car ruts, tires, people spilling drinks, people cleaning cars, and the
chemicals.
The chemicals get on the turf. So we have a numerous amount of things that go wrong.
Now, how many days does it take for this to recoup after the Concours?
Well, kind of weather permitting, it takes about 2 to 4 weeks.
So if they came to you and said, Chris, you know, next year it's going to be in another golf course far away from here, would you be disappointed?
Nope, I would be thrilled.
Chris, well, thank you. You got your work cut out for you. Just because a car is rare doesn't mean it's valuable. This is a classic example of that. This is a Soviet-made 1966 Volga Goss. Even the tires say made in USSR. In fact, this is an old KGB staff car. Believe me, if Boris and Natasha pull up to your house at midnight in this thing, goodbye, comrade! Well, where'd he get a car like this? Well, they turn up an auction once in a while. We went to David Gooding at Gooding Auctions to get a little perspective on how the whole auction game works. We're here with David Gooding, of course, of Gooding Auctions. This is the McLaren F1. What are they thinking, $12 to $14 million range?
12 to 14. This is a 1,000-mile McLaren F1, and many people weren't as lucky as some visionary people to buy one when they were new.
Yes, when they were merely expensive.
Yes.
Yeah. Exactly. Let me ask you about the financial side of auction. What's the average Gooding auction? How many vehicles? 175, 200?
No, actually, at Pebble Beach, we have about 125 cars. This year, we have 122.
Over two nights?
Over two nights, yeah, Saturday and Sunday. And we try to offer a little bit of something for everybody in different price ranges, also different eras. I mean, we have everything from a 1912 Packard all the way up to a new contemporary i8.
Let me ask you something that I always find. Whenever a car like the McLaren comes, whenever a $1 million car or more comes over the block, the next car is always a Fiat Jolly. It's either Fiat Jolly or it's one of those stupid Amphicars. Cars.
Yes.
And because people just paid $2 million for this, they suddenly pay like $150,000 for the Jolly or the Amphicar.
Yes.
Is that fairly common?
Well, you know, you need something to sort of break the ice, as it were. I mean, you know, you're in show business. You know what it's like. I mean, sometimes we can't have $1 million car after $1 million car.
Now, most auctions, you have a different buyer premium up to a certain point. That's not how it works. It's not a flat rate.
Ours is a flat 10%.
Oh, it is? Okay.
Yeah.
A person out there trying to decide whether he wants to buy at auction, are there advantages to buying at auction versus private sale?
Oftentimes, people say if they're buying a car privately, You know, am I paying too much? I don't know where the market is. Who am I bidding against? And the other misperception I think that people have about an auction is they think that at auction they're always paying full retail. And oftentimes there are dealers that buy at our auctions and they get tremendous buys.
Exactly. Let me ask you about the financial side of auctions. You know, I get that catalog in the mail. It weighs usually between 4 and 11 pounds.
Yes.
Those must cost a fortune. You print up hundreds of, well, thousands, I imagine.
But a lot of people don't realize, they think, oh, it's the printing cost, but all the work that we put into it, researching and going to various archives, takes a tremendous amount of time and money. So it's a big investment for us. But it enables us to really learn a lot more about the cars. When you really have to write about them and fact check them, you learn a lot more.
And how many auctions a year does the company do?
We do 3 auctions a year.
Okay,
we do
Pebble
Beach,
right?
Amelia Island, and then Scottsdale.
Well, those are the 3 big ones.
Yeah.
David, thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, David Gooney. We're inside the Bonhams tent, and the 62 Ferrari GTO is the next lot up. So I've never seen an auction this crowded, but every seat seems to be taken. The tent is sold out, and this is supposed to be the most expensive Ferrari ever sold. So we'll see what happens. All right, here we go. Well, you can feel the excitement in the room here. This is unbelievable. This 1962 Ferrari GTO, revving up the engine to get the crowd a bit worked up. That guy's called the Fluffer. Gets the engine going a little bit.
The 1962 Ferrari 250 GTO Berlinetta Chassis 3851 GT. Fresh here from no fewer than 49 years in one single family ownership.
One owner for 49 years. Just made the last payment last week.
A proven race winner. One of the best known and the most often raced of all the GTOs. Here it is, ladies and gentlemen. And start me where you will, I have $10 million off. Any advance on 12? 13, thank you, 14 million, 15 million, 16 million, 17 million, 18 million, 20 million. $20 million I'm offered. $20 million I'm offered, 22 million.
Just past 20 million.
25 million. 26 million, 29 million, 30 million I have at $30 million, $31 million, $32 million, $32,500,000, $32,500,000 at the back, $33,500,000. New bidder, ladies and gentlemen, at $33,500,000, new bidder.
People applauding, how brave.
Spectacular car, one owner for 49 years. The longest single ownership history GTO of them all. $34 million.
I know it seems like a tremendous amount of money, but if a little painting of a guy going like this called The Scream can go for $120 million. This is kinetic artwork, beautiful to look at, so I don't know.
Another small one then at $34 million. Ladies and gentlemen, you're gonna miss it. When are you next gonna get a GTO at auction? It's $34 million, and is the next one gonna be any less?
When I first came to Los Angeles in 1978, there was one for sale for $45,000 in the window of the shop, and I thought that was crazy money. And it was at the time.
Selling the car, are you all finished? No more, we're done. $34,650 to the telephone bidder, $34,650,000. You own the car, $34,650, 727.
The rumor is the Monopoly guy with the cane and the hat may have bought it. But as you can see, the crowd is sort of dissipated after that $34 million sale. And I hear rumors that, oh, it didn't really sell, and, oh, there was the owner buying it back. So you don't know. But this was really hyped. People thought it would sell for $51 or $52 million. Is it a good value? I don't know. What do you think? You think it'll go up? You think the next GTO will sell for more or less? Better than the stock market.
Now, if you can't handle crowds, there's the Quail. It's not inexpensive. It's between $400 and $500 a ticket, but it's limited number of people. You get to move freely among the cars and rub shoulders with some of the most famous people in automobile history.
Talking with John Hennessy here at the Quail. He builds high-performance cars like the Venom. He's done high-performance parts for almost everything, from Cadillac to Escalade. You did my Viper almost
Viper back
20
in the
years
day.
Ago.
Sure.
What is the business plan? When you go to the bank, you say, we're going to sell a car for $1 million. How do you convince them?
Well, the bank is my wife and kids' college fund.
All right.
And so failure was never an option, to kind of quote the NASA guys.
Right, right.
And so the Venom, it was a risky deal from the standpoint that we didn't know if we would sell 12 cars.
Right.
And we had to get to about car number 5 before we hit break even. But now the car is selling at the rate of about 3 cars a year. And not a huge money maker, but it's cash flow positive, and we're here at the Quail.
Is it the fastest car in the world? It's pretty close.
It is. I mean, it ran 270 miles an hour, still accelerating. It's a halo car for our brand, and it was a Hail Mary car from the standpoint of, gosh, if we build it, will people really want to come and buy it?
Right.
But they did, thankfully.
No, it's very impressive. And even the English are impressed, and they're not impressed.
Even the Germans, Herr Dürheimer from Bugatti came by and was very complimentary earlier.
Oh, that's right. Oh, that's
that was
good.
Pretty cool.
You know, with so many car companies going out of business, it's nice to see new car companies coming in, like Hennessy, and of course Tesla, and even most recently McLaren. So.
Yeah, McLaren's got some great products.
Well, it's good to
sure.
see you, John.
Thank
congratulations.
You, Jay. All right, man. Thank you.
This is Don Osborne. He works the sports car market as well as doing independent appraisals. Do people call you before they buy the car or after they buy the car mostly?
The smart ones call me before they buy the car. The unlucky ones call me afterwards. However it happens, I can help them.
Now, how often do people come to you and say, they're at an auction, they saw a car on the stage and they just bought it, and then they ask you what it's worth? That's pretty common, isn't it?
That's alarmingly common, but more often than not, two things will happen. Either someone will get really seduced by the bright lights and the shiny paint and all that and say, wow, that's neat. Most often, when the car doesn't seem to be getting the bids that it should and saying, wow, this is a beautiful car. Why is nobody bidding on this?
Right.
I just put up my hand and suddenly they think they're the smartest guy in the room.
Right. Oh,
and that
okay.
ends in tears.
That ends in tears.
Yeah.
I want to buy a classic car, but I don't want to lose my shirt. What's a good investment right now?
Well, I have to say that for someone who is buying a car under $50,000, investment should not be a concern.
Okay.
What you want to do is ask 3 questions of yourself. Why do you want the car? What are you going to do with it? And what's your budget?
Right.
And those determine exactly what you're going to do and how you're going to carry it out to the best.
Last question, you ever lost money on a car?
Are your cameras rolling?
I rest my case. Donald, thank you.
Thanks a lot, Jay.
We're here at the Concours de Lemons. This celebrates some of the worst cars ever made. Bad engineering, ugly styling, and you can find the one car that combines all those elements. Oh, you could win this thing. How are you? What's your name?
I'm Guy Coulomb. Pleasure to meet you.
Hi, Guy, and this is your car?
This is my car.
And it's got the real fake plastic wood?
The real fake stuff.
Now, this is the LeBaron, right?
LeBaron Town and Country.
So this would be the expensive one.
Yes, this yes, is indeed.
This was the top of the line, what, 86?
86.
Oh, yeah, this is what Lee Iacocca, you find a better car, buy it?
Exactly.
He found a better car. Okay.
I got it for free. It was abandoned in Palm Desert for 6 years.
Any plans to restore it, or are you going to keep it original?
Original restoration. That's my plan for the 12 months.
Single man, I'm guessing?
Single man.
Taking a wild guess? All right. And this is a class. What year is your Yugo?
89.
The Yugo actually wasn't bad. It was based on the Fiat.
Yes.
Does it break down a lot? Does it run okay?
No, it runs really well.
It runs really well. So, by golly, there you go. A woman and her Yugo. Now, we don't want to give the impression that lemons only come in economy cars. Oh, no, no, no. There are some great lemons in the luxury car segment as well. This is the Stutz. Elvis had one of these. I think Sammy Davis had one of these. Robert Goulet had one of these. This was the classic kind of 70s and early 80s excess. It's built on a Bonneville chassis, basically a Pontiac Bonneville you threw another 50 or 80 grand at to make it look worse than a Pontiac Bonneville. But it's got the freestanding headlights. Oh, just give me that disco ball. This, of course, is the American trifecta of bad cars, the Chevy Vega, the classic Pacer, and, of course, America's favorite rolling M80, the Pinto. But no Concours dilemmas would be complete without, of course, the Edsel. My dad used to say the Edsel looked like a Humpmobile sucking on a lemon. That's what he used to say. And this one is beautifully restored. The chrome is perfect. The paint is perfect. But the great thing that makes it a lemon it's an Edsel, by golly. All right, we've seen a lot of crazy cars, a lot of stupid cars, a lot of dumb cars, a lot of dangerous cars, but the one car here that encapsulates all of those elements, and my choice for winner, the 1964 Peel Trident. This is hilarious. Let's meet the owner. Dick, come on over here. Dick, how are you?
Okay.
I love you. How many of these did they build?
I think around 82.
Now, how do you get into it?
You climb in the door. It's a lot easier to get into a 300 SL.
Oh, that's true.
Or a Lotus Elite.
Can I get in?
Yeah, sure.
Let's see what we got.
Everybody gets in.
All right. There's plenty of leg room.
Is there enough knee room?
That's, yeah, there
you
go.
Pull back on the steering wheel.
I'll pull back on the wheel.
Yeah.
I'm sweating already in this thing. Get me out of here! Get me out of here! We'll be right back. Get me out of here! This is Mitch Gross around the lawn here at Pebble Beach. You might remember we started doing the tour and the car broke. I mean, it looked pretty hopeless, but you guys fixed it in a matter of hours, didn't you?
We fixed it in under an hour and we're back on the road.
Can you show us what you did?
Sure, absolutely. So,
now remember how bent this shaft was? There's the man who fixed it right there. Look, he's wearing dark glasses. He's a big star now.
I mean, he's got his long pants on.
And he's got long pants now. You earned the long pants, very good.
So yeah, we straightened out the shaft, Dave did, and then we straightened out the sprocket a little bit, got the chain back on, and then we put a flexible coupling in between the oiler.
Which is probably better than what was there originally.
Which is better than what was there originally. Yeah. And it runs like a champ. We're back on the road in about an hour.
See, this is the fun thing about old cars. You can literally rebuild a car like this for the side of the road. And this car was out of the running, an hour later, boom, it's back on again. You get a vise, you get a big hammer.
Yep.
We don't have blacksmiths anymore, but you straighten it out and look at that. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Thank you. We enjoyed it.
Good luck.
Thanks.
You meet a lot of interesting people at Pebble Beach. Well, this is Frank Kulinick. Am I saying that right?
Yes, yes.
Okay, this is your 69 Tatra?
Yes.
Okay, and this has the V8?
Yes.
But it's different from the T87 V8, right?
Yes, it is, yes.
This has got, what, the Hemi engine, is that correct?
Yes.
Did you ship it here or drive it here from?
Actually, I'm from Toronto, Canada, okay. So we shipped it from Toronto to Silicon Valley.
This is not the Canadian Army outfit, though, is it? No.
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 No, this is actually hopefully an authentic Czechoslovakian colonel's uniform.
Okay.
The problem is I haven't quite figured out how this goes, so I hope it's on the right
yeah,
way.
Yeah, yeah, I don't think I'd be too frightened in battle if I saw that coming at me. But yeah, very nice. Now, is this an original car or a restored car?
It actually is original. The big thing about this is when I got this car in 2006, it was because it was original, it was unrestored.
Yeah.
The original interior.
Yeah, no, it looks good. Did these ever have an automatic transmission or
no?
No, never did.
The only one that did was the 613 Special Grade.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Well, thank you. Thanks
thank
for
you very much. Time. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Well, this is one of my favorite cars here at Pebble Beach. This is a 1936 T77 designed by Hans Ludwinka, one of the first true aerodynamic cars. And this is the owner, Pavel Kasek, am I saying that? Well, nice to meet you, sir.
Nice
wonderful.
To meet you.
And you're the restorer?
Yes, Dalibor Lupik.
Hi, nice to see you. Beautiful, beautiful. And you're the beautiful daughter translating.
Yes, thank you.
Oh, very good. How long did it take to restore the car?
20 years.
20 years? Wow, okay. Well, that's, you don't want to rush it.
Need to take your time for this kind of car.
Well, only now is this car really being seen for the sort of genius that it is. I mean, for years they were just oddities and strange cars. Well, it's beautifully done, and it's nice to have you here. Thank you so much.
Yes, so pleased to be here.
Tell him he is an artist.
You're an artist.
Beautiful job. Thank you. Someday this will be your car.
Yeah, I know. He's excited. Oh, yeah.
This is Jim Blickenhouse. I'm sure you know that name if you're a car enthusiast. He has done some fantastic rebodies, is that fair to say? What would you call it?
Yeah, coach builds.
Coach built Ferraris. Some of the best looking ones I've ever seen. Now it says Ferrari Dino, but Ferrari himself never called the Dino a Ferrari, correct?
This
Ferrari
is the only one.
Oh, is that right?
Yes, when Ferrari saw it,
He said, well, you know, we're going to call this Ferrari 206 Dino Competizione.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
So this, and it's the chassis plate is a Ferrari.
You've become a constructor yourself. You're building cars.
Well, we began with Ferrari P45 by Pininfarina, and we made a race version of it, P45 Competizione, and we raced at the Nürburgring, and we won first in class, and they came to us and they said, look, why don't you become a constructor? So we decided to start clean slate.
Now, do you think next year we'll see one of your cars on the lawn here?
Yes, yeah, so we'll have it. We'll have it.
We can have it out here on display.
Yes, absolutely.
Jim, thank you very much.
Jay, it's great to see you again.
Thanks for what you do for the hobby. It's really
thank
terrific.
You. Yeah.
I got to do this. I got to get one.
Half a crown for the man who can start at one kick. There you go!
That might be a little dangerous for the man part.
Yeah, I know. How did she ride, okay?
Yeah.
Go ahead, climb on.
Well, I hope you enjoyed this all too brief tour of Pebble Beach. You know, we shot a ton of footage this week, and a lot of cars, a lot of technical stuff we just couldn't fit in the show. If you'd like to see that, subscribe to Jay Leno's Garage YouTube channel and check it out. I think you'll like it. Hey, thanks for watching. Mm-hmm.